So welcome, everyone, to the 2021 edition of the Shimpalimo Research Symposium. My name is Joe Patton, and I'm a group leader here and current director of the neuroscience program at Shimpalimo Research. I'm joined on stage by my two co-chairs, Leopoldo Petriano, who is also a group leader here, as well as Jakob Macke, who generously agreed to join us to help bolster the more machine learning side of the meeting. From abroad at his post at the University of Tübingen. Now, under normal circumstances, we here at the Foundation hold these symposia yearly, alternating between topical areas in neuroscience and physiology and cancer, the two main areas of focus within our research. This one, in particular, is a meeting many years in the making, as it was originally scheduled for last year. It was a meeting constructed and dismantled and constructed again on the shifting sands of COVID-related uncertainties. But we're here, and we're so happy to see so many of you make the trip to be here with us and for the possibility of accommodating through a virtual format all of you who are not able to join us physically. Though this hybrid meeting format is new to almost everyone, our hope is that it provides for the best of both worlds. Broader reach and accessibility of the meeting, a smaller carbon footprint, while still offering the richness of in-person interaction and the possibility of connecting the physical and virtual attendees. So here we are, over 300 participants, about 250 in person and another 100 online from 21 countries. We'll have 35 talks, roughly half of them online. In addition to the large number of volunteers, we want to first and foremost recognize the tremendous work of Antonio Monteiro and Anna Kazaka from the events team. Putting this meeting together in particular in a completely new format under incredible uncertainty took impressive judgment, perseverance, and attention to detail. We'll give a more complete acknowledgement of all those who contributed at the end of the meeting, but we think the events team deserves a round of applause for getting us to this point. We're also grateful for the general support of our sponsors, the Trust Fund Faber, the Platinum Partner, the Gatsby Foundation, the British Embassy, Fisher Scientific, Portuguese Society for Neuroscience, and the Portuguese Association for Artificial Intelligence. Many potential sponsors were hesitant to support an in-person meeting during the pandemic, so we deeply appreciate the trust that our partners have put in us and their endorsement of the importance of the meeting. And last but not least, we are, as ever, grateful for the continued support of the Foundation administration, without whom none of this that we see around us, including this meeting, would be possible. So our goal in putting together the symposium was to try to pull together people who work on an array of topics at the interface of neuroscience and machine learning who might not end up talking to each other otherwise, to spark a kind of cross-pollination that furthers the development of multiple fields and forges even stronger synergies between them. The meeting has several focal topic areas, including behavior. The roboticist Rodney Brooks, formerly of MIT's AI lab, made the point that behavior drives intelligence in a now classic paper titled "Elephants Don't Play Chess." In this paper, he argues that the failure of AI to produce really robust intelligence is because we weren't focusing on the hard problems that nervous systems face during evolution, that by jumping to problems like solving strategy games, we're ignoring natural history, one where the first life forms appeared on Earth approximately 4 billion years ago, the first nervous systems 600 million years ago. It then took 599,750,000 more years until just 250,000 years ago for modern humans to appear. So, the human brain, this supposed pinnacle of evolutionary ingenuity, has only been around for 0.04% of the time that nervous systems have existed on this planet. He argues that problem-solving behavior, language, expert knowledge, and application, and reason are all rather simple once the essence of being and reacting are available. We tend to agree, And that's why we focused on behavioral neuroscience and machine learning for behavioral control as one of the central topics.
There's a history of fruitful interactions between machine learning and neuroscience. The first neural networks were inspired by basic findings of how neurons work and how visual information is processed in the neocortex. More recently, the source of inspiration has been in the opposite direction. Training and optimizing artificial neural networks has provided fresh ideas of how brains might deal with similar problems. However, several challenges remain. Each field has its own distinct language and objectives, and what works on the brain might not work for the best in a computer. The ideas originated from artificial neural networks need to be mapped to biological tissue, which might be bound to constraints not present in computers. Conversely, by using increasingly sophisticated methods to measure animal behavior and record large number of neurons, neuroscience is rapidly progressing. Learning how neurons give rise to behavior and animal intelligence can provide further insights to the AI community.
And in addition to these kind of conceptual connections between AI and neuroscience research, machine learning and AI obviously have just also provided very practical tools for neuroscientists. In the last couple of years, the amount and complexity of data that has been generated by neuroscience experiments has exploded, both on the behavior side as well as on the side of large-scale population recordings and large-scale anatomy or connectomics. And machine learning and AI have provided tools that make it possible to analyze this data and to try to distill from them a better understanding of how neural computations underlie intelligent behavior. So this has been an important inspiration or important contribution of AI to neuroscience, but it's important to realize that these interactions are always bidirectional, because the way AI and machine learning have grown in the past is they've grown on the challenges that they try to solve. So by providing difficult analysis challenges, neuroscience is also helping AI in the long run. And these interactions are not only at the level of scientific ideas, but also at the level of people. Because many AI researchers and machine learning researchers actually started off their scientific careers as neuroscientists. So this is another interaction between the two fields. And I think these mutual inspirations between neuroscience and AI will not only be important for neuroscience and AI, but for the products and the insights that will reach into society and other scientific disciplines more broadly. And it's no coincidence that this meeting is, as far as I understand, also the meeting that has the largest fraction of researchers that don't work in traditional academic institutions, but that work in industrial, in labs funded by industry. So I think these interactions between neuroscience and AI also parallel interactions between more fundamental and more applied research. And I think there's enormous potential for the kind of insights that AI is providing to provide solutions that are more broad than just neuroscience in itself. So I'm very happy that we're here. It feels amazing to be in a room with people and to talk about science. I think this is something that is incredibly important to have in addition to interactions over Zoom or remotely. And I think it will be very important to lead these discussions further. So I'm very happy that we can be here. And I'm very grateful to obviously both the foundation and to all of you that we can be here together and discuss how AI and neuroscience can benefit from each other and how collectively we can also provide tools for other scientific disciplines as well as for applications.
So before we get started with the science, I want to give the floor to the president of the foundation, Leonor Beleza, to share with us a few words.
Good morning. In João's name and in my name, it is a very special moment for us to welcome you all to this year's Champalimau Research Symposium. Like so many events last year, we were forced to cancel the 2020 symposium as COVID restricted our plans. As recently as a few months ago, we still were uncertain about our about whether our vaccination program would move fast enough to allow us to relaunch this type of event. But we did it, and I could not be more pleased to be back to this auditorium with you as we took to the future instead of dwelling on difficulties of this past year. But before I move on, I would like to stress one important thing which has been reinforced during this pandemic. Now, perhaps more than ever, society can see that science is at the foundation of our modern lives. The quality of life we enjoy today and the constant advancement in the way we live owes everything to the scientific discoveries that emerge from our labs. The astonishing speed and success of COVID-19 vaccines has placed science and scientists at the center of public discourse. This is very much where we and you belong. And so it is with this in mind that I look forward to this week's discussion. Having missed last year's symposium, this year now marks the 10th Champalimau Research Symposium. This is an important milestone for our foundation, and we are privileged to welcome here some of the world's most outstanding scientific minds to share with us their work. I would like to offer my thanks and gratitude to all those involved in the organization of this year's program, in particular Joe Patton, Leopold Petriano, and Jakob Macke, have done an excellent job as chairs of the symposium. And my congratulations also go to the rest of the organizing team, as Joe has just made, for many months of hard work, really hard work, that have gone into creating the event that we all will enjoy this week. Despite the ongoing restrictions and fears still related to traveling during this pandemic, I am delighted that so many of our 22 invited speakers were able to be with us in person. Given the times, it is an astonishing number and really pays tribute to the passion and dedication you all bring to your fields. I am, of course, grateful to all our speakers and to all our participants this week, and offer a warm welcome also to those who are participating online. This year, we are pleased to be joined by three exceptional keynote speakers. Manuela Veloso is absolutely one of the world's leading experts in the field of machine learning and artificial intelligence. Jim DiCarlo's engineering-based approach to understanding cognition and behavior has made him a pioneer in the fields of artificial vision and artificial intelligence. And Anthony Zador's work at Cold Spring Harbor has made him an authority on how the brain's circuitry gives rise to complex behaviors. All three of our keynote speakers are undisputed leaders in their fields. The fact that they bring their expertise to our symposium highlights both their commitment to this type of discussion, but also the strength of the program created by our chairs. Here at Champalimau Foundation, our philosophy is based on risk-taking, or more precisely, high-risk, high-reward biomedical research. The researchers in this building are motivated to look for the hard answers and to carry out scientific work that can have a lasting impact. Perhaps this motivation is one of the reasons that our research programs have sailed through this pandemic successfully. We are proud of everything they continue to achieve. Since 2007, our neuroscientists have made some exceptional breakthroughs and have been widely recognized for their achievements. In more recent years, Champalimau research has extended into areas of cancer and associated biology. We tried to integrate these areas of research into our clinical facility in order to inspire new ideas and create a strong connection between our scientists and the people who will ultimately benefit from their work. The translational approach to our research in cancer has already yielded significant breakthroughs. And although our neuroscientists focus mainly on basic research, for the time being, it is ultimately their interest in human neural processes and their manifestation in people that inspires their work. This year's symposium could not come at a more auspicious moment for the Champalimaud Foundation. As many of you will have noticed on your arrival, here, the new building that sits alongside our original campus is now almost complete. The Boton Champalimaud Pancreatic Cancer Center was inaugurated last month, 11 years after we opened the doors of the Champalimaud Center for the Unknown, and represents an important new phase in our work. These buildings were designed to connect scientists and clinicians with each other, and also with the patients and their families who come here in search of treatment. This human connection is very important to us here, as a way of being mindful of why we do what we do and what the ultimate purpose of our work is. Alongside the human interactions, we are also, of course, very focused on the future that new developments in technology and machine learning will bring. We are already at an advanced stage in planning our next project, which will develop a comprehensive platform to develop and utilize digital therapy. This is another new area of healthcare which, with the right investments, can offer new tools in the fight against disease. Using advanced software, we will create new solutions that will help improve the cognitive and motor functions of patients with different pathologies in the areas of neurology and psychiatry. This new frontier has emerged from work in our neuroscience program, which will be further enlarged into the disease-related field. And we are indebted to Joe Patton for his vision in identifying this area as one of strategic and scientific importance, and for his leadership in designing a new frontier for our research. So, with its focus on artificial intelligence and machine learning, this year's Champalimaud Symposium is as important as it is timely. In a place like ours, which focuses both on basic science and clinical provision, there is no area of our work which will not benefit from advances in this area in the coming years. This is still a nascent field, and we are still far from understanding how intelligent behavior is produced and how it might be replicated. But we have already seen many examples of its transformative power. I do not think it is any exaggeration to say that the impact of machine learning and artificial intelligence may be like no other we have ever seen. I am therefore excited to welcome you all to this symposium. After 18 months of fear and disruption because of the pandemic, we can now hopefully see some light at the end of the tunnel. But with this light, we can also feel the excitement of our research and the confidence that now, perhaps more than ever, people and communities all over the world value what we do. On behalf of the Champalimaud Foundation, I offer my thanks again for taking the time to be with us this week. And I wish you every success in the work you do in this most exciting of scientific fields. Thank you.